Welcome, everybody. Welcome to this session on the role of glycogen in skeletal muscle regulation and function. And first of all, I'd like to thank you, the organizers of the European College of Sports Medicine, for letting us have this, this session. And we are three speakers this session. First of all, myself, and then I'm happy to have Robin Murphy, Dr. Robin Murphy from the Department of Biochemistry and Genetics at La Trobe University. And then afterwards, it will be Clara Prats from University of Copenhagen. The format of this session is actually that after each talk, we will actually have about 5 to 10 minutes questions. So there will be no questions at the end of the session. So, see, glycogen is actually a branched polymer of glucose. It's actually built, all these glucose monomers are actually built together in this branched structure by the different enzymes, the glycogen synthase and branching enzymes, and also and it's degraded by the debranching enzymes and the glycogen phosphorylase. So all in all, it forms this, this glycogen granule, which is located different places in the muscle cell. And the glycogen we actually have mainly in the skeletal muscle, where we have most of our glycogen, but also in the liver, which actually serves as a to keep the glucose levels in the blood. But also, it's been found in, we have it in the heart, but also in the brain, actually, in astrocytes and other cell types. See, the role of glycogen on in performance was actually first noticed, as I know at least, by Crow and Linhart in 1920, where they aimed to determine the respiratory quotient during ergometer cycling. And actually, it said in the discussion, the very, it's actually a discussion on more than 60 pages. You're not allowed to do that anymore. But it's a fantastic discussion, and they actually say on fat diets, they noticed that fatigue became considerable and sometimes excessive. And later on, this was confirmed by Christensen and Hansen in 1930s, where they actually did some very nice studies on the effect of diet on performance. And then not until the late 60s, there was actually these studies with the first with the biopsy needle technique. And the first study was actually a Nature article on two subjects. Two subjects were also the authors of the article, Jonas Bergström and Erik Hultman. And they had this fantastic design where they were exercising with one leg each. And they did it, was actually one was exercising on an ergometer cycle with the right leg and one with the left leg. And then there's somehow, you can only guess how they did it, but they actually agreed on when they were exhausted. And then they took biopsies after cycling, and then 1, 2, and 3 days after the exhaustive exercise. And that what they could see at that time was actually that the non-exercising leg actually kept its glycogen level throughout the whole exercise and recovery period. However, the exercising leg actually decreased glycogen, and then actually there was a supercompensation during the subsequent recovery days. So that was actually new at that time, and also later on in these studies, they could also show that no matter if they started with high or low glycogen or worked with intermittent exercise or continuous exercise, glycogen was degraded, and there was actually, at the time of exhaustion, it was actually associated with very low glycogen levels. So one of the things with glycogen is actually that it's located at different places inside the muscle cell. I'm going to talk a little more about that in a minute from now. And that's what you see here inside the muscle cell. You can actually see these granules as we talked about before. And that was actually already known in the beginning of the 70s. It was noticed that glycogen actually was stored in these granules, different places in the muscle cell. And also later on, it was also shown that the glycogen granules actually was associated with a lot of proteins, structural proteins, but also proteins in the synthesis and needed for synthesis and degradation. And also it was noticed that it was actually physically interact with this SR membrane, quite a lot of the glycogen. So now we know from that time, we actually know that glycogen actually does affect EC coupling, various steps in EC coupling, and exercise performance has been known for a long time, more than 100 years now. We also know that glycogen affects gene expression, AMP kinase activity, GLUT4 translocation, insulin sensitivity, and glucose uptake, and we actually list up a long list here. So in this session, I'll start off talking about a little bit of exercise performance and EC coupling, especially the calcium regulation, the role of glycogen on calcium regulation. The next talk after me will be Robin Murphy talking about the associated proteins and the effect of exercise on the localization of these proteins also. And then Clara Pratt is going to talk about insulin sensitivity at glucose uptake and the effect of localization of glycogen on these talks. So, with this introduction, I would like to start off talking now about the role of glycogen in skeletal muscle sarcoplasmic reticulum calcium regulation. First of all, to go one step back, when you stimulate the muscle, it's actually the muscle contraction is actually starting with an action potential through the motor nerve, and when it actually arrives at the muscle level. And then at the muscle level, if you go a bit further into this, you can actually see you have these various steps of the EC coupling. This is the sarcolemma you got up here, and this series of invaginations, which is called the T-tubular system. And then you have the contractual apparatus and surrounded by sarcoplasmic reticulum, and they also have mitochondria and so on. So upon arrival of the action potential, it actually spreads along the sarcolemma and down into the T-tubular system, where down in the T-tubular system, it actually affects the voltage-sensitive channels, the dehydropyridine receptors, which somehow in this triad region of the muscle, which is actually covers most of the T-tubular system, you actually have a physical interaction and then opening of sarcoplasmic reticulum calcium release channels. So calcium actually is running out of the, by diffusion, out of the sarcoplasmic reticulum, and the cytosolic calcium increases about 10 to 20-fold, which actually causes a binding to the troponin on the contractual elements, and then you actually have the cross-bridge cycling. And at the same time, you will have a pumping back of calcium to the sarcoplasmic reticulum. So a number of these steps in the EC coupling are dependent on ATP, either directly through the pumping of calcium, the myosin ATPase, or the sodium-potassium pump. But also a number of steps, that is channels, are controlled by ATP levels or energy levels in general. Channels in the T-tubular system, but also the calcium release channel itself is actually dependent on energy levels. So, and this energy is actually derived through various systems. We have glucose or from fatty acids, and here we are going to focus on the role of glycogen. So, glycogen, as I said before, glycogen has actually been, when we did the first biopsy studies actually here in Sweden, in Stockholm, one of the most well-known studies was done by this group of Backstrom, Hermansen, Hultman, and Saltin. They're able to show that if you have a mixed diet, then you have a what you can call intermediate amount of glycogen, and then you, if you exercise at 75% of your to max, then you can exercise it for around 2 hours before you reach exhaustion. And if you then actually are fed with protein, high protein and fat diet, that's no carbohydrate, then you can actually subsequently only exercise for 1 hour. And if you get a lot of carbohydrate-rich diet, then you have high muscle glycogen, and then you can exercise for 3 hours. And that's actually been shown numerous times since then. So it's very fairly well known that at least exercise at these intensities are very much dependent on muscle glycogen level. However, the link between glycogen and muscle fatigue and exhaustion is actually not that well known. It definitely is a energy source, glycogen, but as I said in the introduction, there's also other mechanisms of glycogen. And one of them is actually calcium regulation. And that was maybe most nicely shown by this fantastic paper by Chen and Allen, where they could actually show that, with the single fiber technique, they can stimulate the muscle fiber until exhaustion, as they call 30% of maximum force. Then could at the same time measure calcium. And as you often see in this model and other models, that the decreases in calcium is actually associated with the fatigue level. And they can also, from fiber bundles, show that glycogen levels were also quite low. And what they did then was actually let these fibers recover with the glucose for 1 hour. And then you actually had completely recovered glycogen levels, Maximum force was completely recovered, and also calcium levels was actually significantly recovered also. And the neat thing with this study was that they also did a serious experiments where they let these muscle fibers recover in glucose-free for 1 hour solution. Then they had sustained, as you would expect, reduction in glycogen. And then here you actually had a sustained reduction also in maximum force and also lower levels of intracellular calcium. So titanic calcium. So these data actually show that the changes you see in EC coupling associated with fatigue actually has a component which is glycogen dependent. So that's pretty new at that time. And so going back to our figure here, we can actually say with low glycogen, we can show that titanic calcium levels are actually decreased. That's been shown quite a few times since then. So the question here is actually, why is how does low glycogen actually affect the titanic calcium levels? We did some time ago now. We did some on studies on humans, not only on humans. That was actually human elite skiers, Norwegian elite skiers, where we took biopsies, arm and leg. I'm only going to show you data from the arm now. And we took a biopsy before the race, and also then they made a about 1 hour race in this area here. Finish line was here, and then after 5 minutes, they went into this tent, took a biopsy more, and these samples were transferred for this naturally cooled laboratory we have here, and then we can actually measure glycogen levels. And also in the recovery period, we actually changed, some of the skiers didn't receive any carbohydrate, and some of them actually did receive what they normally would do with optimal carbohydrate for the first 4 hours of recovery. So what we find with glycogen here was actually that if they, I mean, both actually, this is the starting level of glycogen, and actually when they ski, they actually went down to about 30% of the starting level of glycogen. And then when, if they received carbohydrate, they could actually go up to 60%, and then they were fully recovered after 24 hours of recovery, or 22 hours of recovery. However, if they didn't receive any carbohydrate, they were actually still low in glycogen after 4 hours. And if we then actually at the same time measure the amount of or the ability of sarcoplasmic reticulum to release calcium, we can do that in vesicles, sarcoplasmic reticulum vesicles, then you can actually see that when you have low glycogen, at least below 300 millimole of glycogen, you also actually have lower levels of ability, or significantly decreased levels of to release calcium from the sarcoplasmic reticulum. And this is actually a group data. If you have individual data, you can also see the level of glycogen in the muscle compared to the relative SR vesicle calcium release rate. You can actually see there's a nice correlation between the two. Also suggesting that if you go below 250, 300 millimole of glycogen, then you actually see this impairment of calcium release rate. That's actually what we see in numerous studies since then, that you should be below this level. And this is very much in line with another group in Canada from Duhamel. They actually made a series of studies with the same aim. They could actually show if you start with high cycling with high glycogen levels from the beginning or with lower glycogen levels, you actually see they took biopsies after half an hour and exhaustion with low glycogen levels and also exhaustion with high glycogen levels. If they measured in exactly the same way as we do, calcium release rate, they could actually see when you have a significant lower release rate or impaired release rate, that's actually occurred also if you have low calcium levels. The authors here didn't actually notice that, but I would actually suggest again that when you're below 300 to 250 to 300 millimolar, then you actually see this decrease in SR calcium level or release rate. So we actually done that also in, this is actually prolonged exercise you saw. We also done recently done that in 4x3 minutes intermittent exercise all out with these skiers. We'd also done it with four hours exercise all out with the elite triathletes and so on. And we actually always see that you have a decrease calcium release rate, which is fairly nicely associated with low glycogen levels. So what you can see now is actually that low glycogen levels actually affects the calcium release rate, which in turn affects the intracellular titanic calcium levels. So see, what I've been talking so far is actually the glycogen where we measure it in a biochemical way. So we just get what you traditionally do in a homogenate, and then you actually express it as a concentration like millimolar per kilo dry weight. This tends to view it as a homogeneous distributed substance. But and you actually get a single value, and therefore assume that the glycogen content is the same in all regions of the cell. And you can actually say it is definitely not. If you actually look at these electron microscopy pictures, you can see that you have different pools. Inside the muscle fiber here, you can actually make a magnification, and this is 40,000 times magnification. Then you can actually see these black dots in here, and that's actually what we know is these glycogen granules. And a lot of them is actually located inside the myofibrils, between actually near the Z line in the I band of the muscle fiber. And then you also have a lot of glycogen located around the each of these myofibrils. And then you also have a pool just beneath the subsarcolemma. That's actually what you see up here. You have the sarcolemma up here, capillary you have here, and all the myofibrils. So you also have a pool up here. And the distribution of glycogen is in humans that you have around 10%, 10 to 15% in the subsarcolemmal area, a bit more in this inside the myofibrils, and the main part, about 7 to 80%. Is situated what we call the intermyofibrillar region, that's around the myofibrils. This is two dimensions, and that's what we take pictures. So you tend to think in two dimensions also, but you should actually think in three dimensions. So I tried to help you with that. This is actually the pictures you saw before, and this is a cross-sectional area of a muscle fiber. The subsarcolemmal area is easy to understand. That's just located just below the sarcolemmal here, in a very small space. But glycogen, is, even though you only got 10%, it actually has a very high density here in the subsarcolemmal area. But if you then do a cross-sectional area, we actually have a picture. First, this part of the picture is taken where you actually cut the fiber here in the A-band, and you can see there's hardly no glycogen inside the between the myosin, and only a little of glycogen around each of the myofibrils. But if you actually take a closer look at the, if you look at the here in the I-band, you can actually see you have a lot of glycogen in between the actin monomers. And you can also see that this is actually the I-band here. You can also see you have a lot more glycogen around each of these myofibrils. You can even see some mitochondria and SR T-tubular system here. So it's actually wrapped around the myofibrils. So is that important? You can say yes, it is actually, because when we look at this, is actually from the skiers again, the skiing study, subsarcolemmal area, and this is actually the intermyofibrillar area and the glycogen around the myofibers. Before the exercise and after 1 hour of exhaustive exercise, you can actually see by eye that you got a lot less glycogen here and also in this region. And if you actually try to put numbers on it, you can say, well, it decreased in the subsarcolemmal area to about 30%, and also between the myofibers, 30%, but actually a lot more in the intermyofibrillar area. And that's also what we see often, even no matter if you do high-intensity exercise, we do isolated preparations or whatever, you often use a lot more in the intermyofibrillar area. And then you can say, well, is that important? It is actually, because if you try to look at the correlation between the calcium release rate from the sarcoplasmic reticulum, if you try to correlate that with the different pools, it actually always turns out that intermyofibrillar glycogen is the one which correlates best, or sometimes only correlates, with the calcium release rate. So it seems like the intermyofibrillar glycogen is closely associated with and apparently important for the calcium SR calcium release rate. So this pool is important for this part of the EC coupling. We wanted to go a bit further on that to see if there was a direct link between intermyofibrillar titanic calcium levels and these different pools. So we did a study together with the Håkon Westerblad group at Karolinska, where they have this unique model where you can have an intact fiber at the same time as you're measuring force in this fiber with tendons in each end. You can also measure intracellular titanic calcium. And as they often see when you do a fatigue protocol, the intercellular calcium actually decreases and is closely associated with the fatigue, at least in these protocols. So we did various protocols here, and also at the same time we did EM analysis on these single fibers, so before and after this exhaustive exercise. And what we could see in this preparation, you could see that, well, in the subsarcolemmal region, there were no association with the calcium, with the titanic calcium. there's a tendency to a correlation with the intramyofibrillar glycogen, but the intramyofibrillar glycogen, which actually was associated always with the calcium release rate, was also quite closely or quite well associated with the titanic calcium levels. So we wanted to see now, well, now we're pretty sure that intramyofibrillar glycogen is important for the calcium release rate. Is it what's the mechanism? So we wanted to see if it's ATP dependent. And we have this model which was actually invented by George Stevenson and Graham Lamb at La Trobe University, which it's called the mechanical skin fiber. And then here you actually isolate a fiber, and you can actually grab with some forceps, you can actually grab the membrane and peel it off. Like and we always say, like it's like taking a stocking off a leg. So and then you actually have this intact on our skin fiber here, but still actually with all the myofibrils and glycogen and so on inside. And going back to our picture here, you can see what you actually do is actually you grab the sarcolemma and then you actually peel it off. And what happens is actually that you seal off the T-tubular system and you have all the steps in the EC coupling intact. So you can, from this, when you actually mount the fiber in a solution mimicking the intracellular solution, you can actually do action potentials activated force contractures just as in the intact muscle. And at the same time, you can investigate the different steps in the EC coupling. So what you can do here is actually, the unique thing is actually we can keep ATP and creatine phosphate, the energy levels high, or you can say the global ATP high, while at the same time stimulating at different steps here in the EC coupling. And the question now is actually, if you keep ATP high, global ATP high in this fiber, do you then actually still see an effect of low glycogen in these fibers? So this is red fibers we're looking at now. So we have some skin red fibers, and we actually, this is a fiber with high intramyofibrillar glycogen. We can stimulate the fiber, and then we can actually determine how much glycogen you have. We can actually determine how much glycogen you have in the fiber before you stimulate it. And there you can see it's fairly endurance, this fiber, compared to a fiber with low intramyofibrillar glycogen. And there was actually a very nice correlation between how much intramyofibrillar glycogen you have and the time to endurance, just as you see in the whole body exercise. And at the same time, you can see in the fresh fiber, you can see if you got a lot of that glycogen you have between the myofibrils, this is actually the fiber you have here. And if you have low, that's the yellow-red one you have here, the orange one, intramyofibrillar glycogen, if that is low, that's actually prolonged relaxation time. And there's also quite a nice correlation between relaxation time and the amount of glycogen you have in this region. So to sum up with these skin fibers, you can actually see, well, you have these two pools, one pool around the myofiber, one pool inside the myofiber, what you call intramyofibrillar glycogen. What you have around is actually myofibrils is important for muscle relaxation, and that seemingly is the calcium uptake, and you actually have these calcium pumps around this area of the muscle fiber, so it does actually make physiological sense. And when the intermyofibrillar region is actually in the myofibrils, is important for endurance, calcium release rate definitely, and also has some recent data, I'm not going into that in this talk, on also affecting the sodium-potassium pump maybe. So, we actually believe that intermyofibrillar glycogen is important. We have different at different levels. We know that it's important for calcium release rate, muscle titanic calcium levels, and also fatigue resistance. And inter- and subsarcolemmal glycogen are not important for that. So we actually found out, we have used different models. We used mouse muscle, we used rat muscle, we also used different human muscles. And from these, you can actually see if you look at the various proportions of the different pools, we have the subsarcolemmal, the intermyofibrillar glycogen, and the intermyofibrillar glycogen around the myofibrils. You can actually see that the mouse fibers, fast twitch fibers, they have a huge amount of, or relatively large amount of intermyofibrillar glycogen, 70%. The rat has a bit less, and humans have around 10 to 15% in this intermyofibrillar region. And there's actually no difference between type 1 and type 2 fibers, significant difference, only in trained actually. So this is actually the relative distribution. If you look at the total amount of glycogen you have in mouse, rat, and humans, it's actually notable that humans have a lot. We actually regulate glucose in a quite different way from these rodents. Humans have about 4 to 5 times more, even 6 times more glycogen than mouse, and about four times more glycogen than rat muscle. So if you times the relative distribution and the total amount of glycogen you have in the muscle, then you can actually see that the intermyofibular region and also in the subsarcolemmal region, there's a huge difference between species. But strikingly, it's actually this intermyofibular glycogen is quite constant in absolute terms between mouse, rat, and human different fiber types. And that actually leads us to think, this is just a proposal, that intermyofibular glycogen is actually important for the glycogen release, and it's that important that you need to have a certain amount of glycogen in the intermyofibular region. And even though if the mouse have very little glycogen, it actually still chooses to have most of its glycogen in the intermyofibular region. So that's quite striking to us to have this comparative approach. There will be more species coming soon on this. So, in a way to sum up, you can see, well, skeletal muscle EC coupling, it's actually starting with the action potential, then subsequent the calcium release, intercellular titanic calcium levels increases, then you have the force production. And if you try to measure these steps at different levels, you can either have the SR, sarcoplasmic reticulum vesicle, mechanical skin fiber, intact fiber, whole muscle, or whole body. You can actually see how does glycogen actually affect these different steps. We know from the mechanical skin fiber and also from whole body data that it actually low glycogen levels would actually, or at least like glycolytic derived energy actually is needed for the sodium potassium pump. We know from the SR vesicle that that low glycogen levels is actually affecting SR calcium release rate. And we also know from the intact fiber that the low calcium levels has actually been shown quite a lot of times affects intracellular titanic free calcium. And also from a lot of levels, we know that also low glycogen would actually affect endurance and force production also. So it's pretty convincing, I think, with these different levels, we can actually show that the low glycogen levels actually affects the calcium regulation. So in conclusion, it's actually strongly indicated that glycogen has a role in maintaining normal skeletal muscle function. And this glycogen might be more than just an energy reserve. It may also regulate some of the steps in the EC coupling. And we have defined these three, we and colleagues have defined these three pools. Intermyofibular glycogen, which is related to SR calcium release, and also preferentially used during exercise. We know that. And as I said before in this talk, also during prolonged exercise, but also during high-intensity exercise, you actually use relatively more of this glycogen pool compared to the other pools. And the intermyofibular glycogen fuels mainly SR calcium, the pumps, and the subsarcolemmal glycogen is apparently not involved in any of these in any of this calcium regulation. So also, I haven't presented data on that. Actually, with the intermyofibular glycogen, yes, I actually showed you that it's actually constant within these species, mouse, rat, and humans. And also, we know by training, it actually increases in type 1 fiber. So if you take this training, I mean endurance-trained persons, they actually have a lot more intermyofibular glycogen in their type 1 fibers. And we also know from immobilization studies, the opposite, that you actually decrease a lot more in the intermyofibular region than the other regions glycogen with the immobilization. So I'll end off saying just with acknowledgement and thanking, first of all, Joachim Nielsen, who's my colleague, who's actually doing these EM pictures and this very elaborate work, counting glycogen and other substances in the muscle fiber. And then with all the ski studies and on the sickle fiber studies from Mid-Sweden University, Bengtsaltin, and also colleagues from Karolinska Institute. And with that, I will say thank you for your attention and be happy to take questions from now on. And the questions, Robin Murphy will actually be in charge of that.
I will, yeah. I'll take charge. So do we have questions? We have a roving microphone that will wait. I might start things off, Niels, because... I think you might know this, but with super compensation, do humans end up with more intramyofibrillar glycogen.
Once again, with?
Supercompensation.
All right, yeah. Mm.
Does it end up in that site? Because it seems to be particularly important. And then given the mouse data, there seems to be a lot more space in there. So, you know, I was always thinking it was a little bit constrained by the space between the myofibrils, but that might not be the case. So can you elaborate on that at all?
Well, it's a straightforward question. I actually will be happy to answer it if I could. We have not been looking at untrained persons with supercompensations. We never taken biopsies before and after that. We only done it in trained persons, and trained persons are probably supercompensated all the time. So the only thing I can say, in trained persons, actually in the recovery period, you don't get more in any of the pools. You're actually getting back to this normal level, you can say. So no pool is actually preferably used before the other one, or filled up before the other one. But we can see in the early early recovery, you actually get first, actually, you that there's a tendency, I would say, that you fill up the intermyofibrillar region before the other ones. So it's actually full before the other ones. We've seen that in recovery after soccer, but also recovery after skiing exercise.
Yes.
Thank you, Nils, for a very nice presentation. With regard to the reduction in the intermyofibrillar glycogen stores and the reduction in calcium release, I think you mainly showed the reduction in tetanic force, but it should theoretically also affect rate of force development quite a lot. And do you know if it also contributes to the low frequency fatigue?
I mean, it would contribute to low frequency, definitely, and it's a good point. It would also contribute to rate of force. I mean, you would think if it was a limiting factor. We cannot see that in these, but that's the only way where we've seen it is actually in this mechanical skin fiber, and apparently there is no difference in rate of force in these preparations. But that's also fast twitch fibers. I don't know. It could be debated if calcium release would actually be a limiting factor of rate of force development. I would believe so myself, actually, but we don't really know, actually. So that's a good point. Yeah.
Lawrence here.
Thank you for a very clear presentation. I just wondered, at the end, you stressed the changes in the intrastore on type 1 fibers. But do you have any data, or are you aware of any studies that have emphasized looking at the type 2 fibers in sort of stop-and-go sports where a lot of the glycogen breakdown would be for sprinting and changing directions and so forth?
No, I mean, so far we've only been looking at at least elite athletes in more prolonged exercise. But you could actually say, well, with the last data we have on that sprint skiers, but they are pretty much also they're quite good. They also do a lot of prolonged exercise. But in these skiers, there's no difference actually between type 2 and type 1 fibers. But metabolically, type 2 fibers are actually quite equal to type 1 fibers also in these, at least in these subjects, arm subjects. So I wouldn't know, but you would actually think that they would if you're using the type 2 fibers more in stop and go exercises, you say you would have more glycogen in these regions.
I think that's a good point that in humans, as well as some of the concentration differences you mentioned, the type 1 and the type 2 fibers, depending on the stress you give them, are quite similar. Unlike the rodents.
Any other questions? Clara.
Hi, thanks a lot. Fantastic talk. Nils, do you have, because every time I'm looking at these beautiful EM images and the particles in the different compartments, I always wonder, do you think that the intermyofibrillar particles are moving, or like where do, are they like started in different compartments? Are they moving from one to the other one? You know, if you deplete intramyofibrillar, will then the intermyofibrillar come and kind of fill the gap?
Yeah, with our data and also what we've been looking at other, I mean, there could be debate a little, some of the earlier data maybe could show you that you have less particles at the fatigue. I actually think that Fredin showed that. But in all our data, we cannot, I mean, when you decrease your glycogen levels, it's actually because the diameter of each granule is getting smaller. You don't get fewer granules. So that's probably the answer for your question. I mean, you don't move them. But it could be actually sometimes we, when you're very low in glycogen, you actually get fewer granules. But I cannot say if that's methodologically. I mean, sometimes the granules are getting so small you can't see them on the EM pictures.
So you think more that it will never disappear, a granule? It will only kind of, the core always stays and then you resynthesize from
yeah, that would be, let's say, that would be my guess, actually. We've got no data showing that fewer particles and so on, yeah. Mm.
I've got another one for you, Niels, that I think sort of needs an answer, and that is that low glycogen is decreasing sarcoplasmic calcium, reticulum calcium release, but that's not an ATP-dependent process. Oh. So is there, can you describe the connection there?
I'd be happy to speculate on that, actually. But you're sure it's not ATP-dependent, not directly, but it's actually indirectly ATP. You actually have ADP binding and ATP binding sites on the, and even phosphorylation sites on the on the calcium release channel. And also you can say, well, where you have this calcium release channel, it's in the triad region, which is a very restricted place. So even though you have normal ATP, as we can keep for sure in the mechanical skin fiber, you could actually have lower ATP levels in the region. But it could be ATP per se, or it could also be AMPK or whatever, other phosphorylation sites on the binding channels. But it's not directly dependent on ATP, you're right. Mm.
Okay, I think I'll hand back to you now, Neil.
Yep.